Okay, I am with Noel Gallagher, who I'm very happy to say has got shades on.
Just through necessity, I'm afraid. I was out late last night.
It's early this morning. It's a rock and roll tradition, and
it's... you kind of are kind of allowed to wear them indoors, particularly if you're a rock and roll star.
And I like a bit of distance from an interviewee. It's like blind date.
I did. I said to you before we started, I'm not being rude. I genuinely was kind of up at 10 to 6 this morning.
You look great.
Oh, thank you very much.
I'm just feeling bad that I didn't wear them as well. That would have been brilliant.
You should have some Absolute Radio embossed ones.
They probably exist. Yeah. So I tell you what, I had a look at the last time I interviewed you.
It was on TV, wasn't it?
It was. It was 17 years ago this week.
No.
It was.
Wow, that's insane.
And the interview ended with you saying, you know, it's a young man's game, rock and roll. And you said, but knowing my luck, I'll probably still be doing it when I'm 50.
Did I say that?
And here we are.
And here we are.
Yeah.
Well.
So why?
Who'd have thought? Well, because I'm not really, I'm not interested in anything else.
But you don't need to work, do you?
No, but I guess because, it's like, if you're a bass player, right, or a drummer, they're the kind of people who don't need to work. But I write, so I love the writing. And if you write, then you're kind of obliged to go out and play gigs, I suppose. But I do like it. I love it. The travelling and the, I guess, being creative kind of keeps you doing it.
It's good, because the thing people usually go off, they like, as you say, the creative stuff, but they don't like the hotels and the
there is a funny, there's a when you first start and you're travelling the world in 5-star hotels, it's like the greatest thing ever. But then when you've made that money that your house is better than any hotel that you stay in, you're kind of always in,
yeah.
You know, I live in a 6-star house. This 5-star hotel, it's not going to cut it anymore. But
I tend to stay at mid-range hotels now. they're just more excited to have me.
When you start staying in hotels that double as spas,
yeah.
That's when you know you've cracked it.
Oh, you've landed then.
Here's your room service menu and your spa menu, sir.
Oh,
yes,
man. You go for a meal and there's someone in a robe at the next table.
Yeah. Or checking in, people in flip-flops.
So what would you say... No, you do and have done a lot of interviews. What would you say was the question you're asked most? Not just in interviews, in the street, by anyone.
How's it going? I would say... I guess it's the question Paul McCartney gets asked the most. So, what was it like?
Oh, yeah.
What was it like? Well, I don't know. It was just... It's what it was. You know, McCartney says he gets asked that a lot. So what was it like being in the Beatles? Well, it was my normality, I suppose. But the 90s, what was that like? It was great, is my answer to that, I think.
I interviewed Ringo once, and he said that if a bloke comes round to mend his boiler, he's waiting for the B word,
right,
to come up. I mean, do you feel like that about it with the O word? Do you sort of think, oh?
No, I think it's great. I do. You know, you have to be of the mindset that if you're hailing a black cab, 99% certainty that the guy that pulls over is going to be an Oasis fan,
right?
And you know, I won't charge you. You give me so many great memories, son.
Oh.
And I'm just like, there's only 2.20. You know what I mean? I won't charge you, they say. You know, it's like £2.60. No, it's on me, mate. Oh, thanks.
It was worth all that touring for that.
I saved £2.60 there.
I asked Alan Shearer what he gets asked the most. What would you guess that was? Think of all his achievements, England player, you know, top scorer in the Premier League.
So it's got to be something ridiculous.
I'll tell you what it is.
Go on.
It's, do you regret not signing for Manchester United?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
A negative. Horrible. So what makes you happy now, Noel? What, you know, that sort of white heat happiness that you get? It's not necessarily from big things, but sometimes it's just little things.
It's not one general thing. I suppose it goes without saying, your family moments.
Yeah.
When, you know, you're playing football with two lads in the back garden. But then odd things. I can be kind of sat in a hotel room and I actually have a day off and I've actually have nothing to do in a town where you're not even interested going out in because you've been there so often. And you just think, let's just lie on this bed all day and just watch telly.
Oh, that's great, isn't it?
That kind of thing is just like, it doesn't get any better than this.
Get your robe on.
Let's peruse through the spa menu. See if I can get a toe rub from somebody. The tiny little things, I guess. I suppose once you're good at what you do and you're successful, it's the little things that make you happy, I suppose. Mm. What about you?
I like sitting with the newspaper in the garden.
Right.
Okay. Just that.
In the middle of winter.
Yeah, ideally in the middle of the winter, but heavily lagged.
Right.
Yeah, because, you know, everyone thinks it. I mean, I don't do any drugs, alcohol, anything now, and that's where I used to get my white heat happiness from.
Right.
But now I get it from very minor things.
Yeah, it's the little things.
I watch Supersonic, the movie about Oasis. Mm. Were you pleased with that?
Yeah,
it's a cracking film. I'd recommend it.
Yeah, it's good. I like it. It's nice that it focused on the glory years, and it didn't. Actually, to the producer's credit, he said we were going to make a film acknowledging whatever the anniversary was. There's always an anniversary in the music business, and he said we're not going to do the downside. We're going to focus on this 2.5 years from when you signed off to when you walked on stage. And I said, what did you say? 2.5 years? This hangover I've got now will last probably a healthy percentage of that. You know, 2.5 years, and going from like signing off to doing those gigs is like, it was incredible.
Mm.
And but it was good. It was good. There was a lot, it was nice reminiscing and some of the memories and then seeing some of the footage that I never knew existed. And it was nice. It was good.
There's a bit in it where the first album is on the shelves, and you say, I'm cursed to be eternally bored now, because it was all about this. It was all about getting that first album.
Yeah, that was it. The ambition of Oasis went in stages. It was kind of like, let's get a record deal. Then after that, let's make an album. And after that, it was like, okay, we've got to do another one now. It's good to have already written it.
Yeah.
And then even now, today, it's kind of, you just take one cycle at a time, you know what I mean? And
but there is something about the thrill of the climb, which you never... Because you're never going to leave the top of the mountain now.
No, you get to a point... The difficult bit is when you get to that point and you flatline is staying there. When the thrill of that ride, honestly, it was just incredible. No 2 weeks were the same, and you would get calls, and it was all the digital age and social media and that. So it was kind of old school, and you'd actually have to answer the phone to someone.
Yeah.
I'd pick up the phone with a lead in the end of it. Oh, it's got a lead in the end of it. Yeah.
You could find them then. They were plugged in.
Yeah. And it was just like no 2 weeks were the same, you know. You get a call saying, you know, you've sold 1 million records in, you know, Mogadishu. You're just like, no way. Seriously. Thank you very much.
And then where's me Atlas?
Yeah.
Do you think towards... Because I saw Oasis several times. Do you think that there's a danger with a band that gets that massive that quickly? That you could end up... Look, I've seen Paul McCartney, and I don't want him to play anything post-Wings. I just want him to recreate that special time in my life. Do you think that Oasis fans got a bit like that? They wanted to freeze you in time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They do have a sense of ownership of your thing. It's like with this record now that's coming out next week, it's quite different to what I do. And it's more electronic, and there's people singing in French and all that kind of thing. And the thing with Oasis is it generates a new generation of fans every 5 or 6 years, and it feels like there's a generation has come along now, and they're really young, and they have an image of what they think you should be, and they take ownership of it. But you can't... I guess it's nice and all that, but you can't, when you're in the studio creating something, you can't think, well, what would my fans want? You can't think that. So when you go to do the gigs, it's kind of as long as you can play what you want, then you play what they want as well. You give them a, you know, blast from the past and all that.
It's a deal, isn't it? Every gig is a deal.
Of course,
with
it's
the
like you say when you go see Paul McCartney, you know, it's like, imagine if he only did Wings stuff.
Yeah.
You'd be like, all right, we get it, come on, but, you know, give us a hard day's night.
Yeah, but it could be worse. Yeah. It could be everybody's going to dance tonight.
Or the Frog Chorus. You
yeah.
know.
Well, you know, in context, that wasn't so bad. So let's talk about the new album. I'll be honest with you, it took me 5 listens.
Wow.
To get it.
Right.
Which I would say is a good sign.
Yeah.
Because I don't know about you, but with albums, they're a bit like people. If I like someone instantly, I've often gone off them in 3 months. Whereas with an album, if it grows organically on me, it tends to stick.
Yeah,
there.
I agree. And the funny thing is when I was making it, because it took 4 years to make, and because it kind of grew step by step, I didn't realise how different it was until I started to play it to people. Two after every track. When I first played Holy Mountain to my management, Dan heard it. At the end of the song, there was silence, and my manager went, "Are they all like this?" Now, I went, "What?" He said, "Are they all like this?" I said, "No, some of them are even worse, you know." And it was like silent. It didn't, until, because they'd just been given this completed thing, they were like, "Wow, it's very different, isn't it?" And I was like, "Is it?" And then I was like, "Yeah, I guess a girl making an announcement in French is kind of not done that before. It's kind of different."
It felt to me like you had made a conscious effort to make something different. Is that not true?
No. If I'd have made a conscious effort, the album wouldn't be that good, because you're immediately starting to overthink it. I must do something different. My producer, David Holmes, he just refused any song that I'd written outside of the studio. I didn't want to know. He wants to be the genesis of this idea, and then he would point me in a different direction. And every time I would come up with stuff that sounded remotely like Oasis or what I'd done before, he would stop me and say, "Well, you've heard all that. You can do that next time. Why don't we focus on this germ of electronic music and turn that into a song?" And I found it, for the first 18 months, 2 years, quite frustrating, because I've got a bank of songs at home. I just go in and, you know, we'll do them in 10 minutes. And
how many you got, do you think, lying around?
I say I've got completed, ready to go, I've got another 2 albums worth, easy.
Wowee.
And I've got a lot of songs that just need knocking into shape. But he was very good at saying, he would like stroke my ego by saying, "You're the acoustic guitar thing, you're the greatest. You're the best in the world. Nobody can touch you. But, you know, I don't like it." And he'd be like, "Oh, okay, well, okay." Pass me the synthesizer.
It's not that much, because I think of you as, although you were in a band, that the writing process, I remember there's a bit in Supersonic where you go off into a room where everyone else is eating a takeaway, and then you come out with, I think it's the track.
Supersonic, yeah, Supersonic, yeah.
So it must be odd to have someone over your shoulder, especially if they're saying, "Don't do that."
Well, I guess because I've made so many records, the thrill of the unknown was what kept me interested. Every day was different in the studio. I remember coming home from the studio one night and my missus saying to me, "How did it go today?" I was like, "I have no idea." She said, "What did you do?" I was like, "Well, I played a synthesizer for 7 hours. She's like, "You can't play the synthesizer." I was going, "I know." You know, and then you'd go back in the next day and the 7 hours of music you'd done, I've never heard them since. I don't know where they went. Probably on David Holmes' solo record next year. So it was all very, some days you would go in and nothing would happen and you'd toil away, no ideas. And then another day you go and you get 3 ideas that would make, you know, a couple of tunes. So it was all very, if you've got the right attitude, it's all very interesting.
Well, it's when it starts off, the first track, Fort Knox, I'm looking at my watch after about a minute and a half, thinking, they've sent me the wrong album. Where's Noel?
Yeah. Somebody said to me in the same management thing, this is a long intro, isn't it? And I said, no, this is it. This is it. And there was another one. So are you singing on any of it? Yes, singing comes in after 2 minutes. You say, look, there I am.
But it's a great track, I think, Fort
brilliant.
Knox.
It's brilliant.
And you have one line on it, you've got to get yourself together. It's a great opening.
Well, it was a traditional song. It had a verse and the chorus and all that. And I didn't feel it was working. When I started to take the vocals out, it started to kind of, oh, hang on a minute, there's something different here. And I love it.
It's tribal,
yeah.
I'd say.
Yeah.
Dare I say, and this is a compliment, it's got a bit of Happy Mondays about it, I think.
That's what people have said. It's a bit Madchester.
It's that part of Manchester which I think you've always avoided a bit.
No, I just never knew how to get there. I mean, I've worked with the Chemical Brothers in the past and Goldie back in the day and all that kind of thing. So I was a regular at the Hacienda. But if you're sitting down with an acoustic guitar and you can knock out a tune like Don't Look Back in Anger in 10 minutes, you're just like, well...
You might as well.
It might as well, isn't it? It'd be rude not to. I'm not fanning around with a synthesizer for 7 hours.
Now you've done that. I'll tell you, I listened to a show on Radio 4 once and they had a bloke who was an expert on sea anemones. And one of the questions, sea anemones, those things that blow about on the bottom of the sea, they're like plants.
Oh, right, okay.
And this woman said to him, how do you know when they're dead? It's a great question. He said, in science, there's only one way of recognising life for sure, and that's growth. And if you've got growth, you've got life. Oh. And that is true of musicians,
yeah, of
presumably.
Course. Yeah. I think you have to try at least, you know. And I think my solo stuff after I left Oasis was kind of heading this way. There was things that, you know, like on Chasing Yesterday, there was kind of like a space jazz tune, which is so far removed from Supersonic. It's a joke. And some of my fans thought it was a joke.
Yeah.
But I guess you have to. If you get kind of stuck in that time warp, this is what I do. I don't think it's interesting for anyone. And I think if my third album was the same as the other two, I'd be bored of it by now. Do you know what I mean? But I think you have to. You have to at least try anyway.
The Man Who Built the Moon, that's a great track.
It is, isn't it?
It's a really...
Yeah.
I love that.
Mm.
To me, that... I think the problem you've got, probably...
Is I'm too
if
good.
If it's a problem, is you're sort of competing with you.
Yeah.
And the thing is with Oasis, it wasn't just that people liked them. They got into their emotional interiors. I mean, we saw that in Manchester with After the Bombing for Don't Look Back in Anger. That then it's not a song anymore.
No, it's a thing. It was amazing how people rallied around that song in the days after that. It was quite the thing. And I get asked about it a lot, and I've been doing recently, and it's kind of almost gives me goosebumps, really, that in the days after that, politicians' words weren't enough. You know, the comforting words from experts on the news wasn't enough. People rallied around a song, like old school, you know what I mean? It was kind of... And the night I did it in Manchester, you've got these mixed emotions of, you live for these moments where, you know, what you've created has gone into people's lives. So you're there, and it's for all the wrong reasons, you know what I mean? And so that song is, I think, without it being an extraordinary song, it's an extraordinary thing, you know, because for 20 years it was a song of no regrets, and it was about a girl who was... maybe was toasting her life, passing her by, and now it's become this anthem for defiance, you know.
Well, it's like it's got a religious aspect to it, I thought. I mean, you say when I watched that on the news and people started singing that in the street, the hairs went on the back of my neck. It never occurred to me how it felt for you.
I was actually watching it at the time, and I couldn't believe it. I actually couldn't believe it. And, and then... A couple of weeks later, the band played it in the Stade de France before the England-France friendly. And my seven-year-old, for a week he was just going, did they play this song everywhere? And I was like, yes, they do.
So I tell you what surprised me a bit, and I don't know how much control you have over this, and it's the timing of your album coming out being so close to your brother's.
Yeah, I never thought about it until I started doing these interviews, and journalists were saying, "Is it just coincidence?" And I was like, "Well, yeah, you know." I finished mine. The way the music world is now, you can't sit on it for too long, or it just leaks. You know what I mean? Mm. So it was ready to go, and that was it. I don't see. I kind of know now it's a bit of a big deal, but at the time, it never entered my thinking at all. I knew he was making a record while I was making this one.
Mm.
Because I don't know whether you're aware of this, he's a pretty good self-publicist. And we were like, oh, he must have a record coming out. And but we set the date and that was it. You know, you can't kind of... I sent to a journalist yesterday, so when do you think it should have come out? Next year? The year after?
Well, I just wonder if you are... And it seems to me you are someone now who's trying to break new ground musically. I don't know if competition is always good to help you to be brave and take risks. Do you know what I mean?
But it doesn't matter, because the way... The press will always invent competition anyway. You know, if... The fact that we're both now making records is a thing, no matter when my album comes out or when his comes out, they're just always going to be compared. Same when they formed BDI and did that thing, there was the comparisons there. That's just the way that it is.
Mm.
So you just got to focus on what you're doing, that's it, you know. But
I sort of resolved I wouldn't mention Liam today, but now I've lapsed into it. I'm sorry. It's odd, you know. Many years ago, you won't remember this, but I was with you and him, and he was standing by a vase of flowers, and he had pollen on the back of this black... He had a sort of black polo neck, sort of with the Beatles right. type of jumper, and he had all this orange pollen, and he didn't know because it was on the back, and you brushed it off for him, and I remember thinking that was a lovely brotherly thing.
Right. Sure, I haven't just sneezed into my hand.
No. I just think it's sort of... I remember thinking it must have been great, you know, to have gone through all that and have your brother with you.
Well, yeah. Yeah, but it was also... Oasis, I say in the documentary, Oasis's greatest strength was also its Achilles heel, you know what I mean? Because two brothers in a band singing harmonies, one writing songs for the other, is kind of unique, you know? But then it kind of eventually... became exhausting, the kind of sibling thing.
Yeah.
And, I remember towards the end of Oasis thinking, I'm too old for this now. It's like we're still squabbling like two, you know, 12-year-olds. It's not for me anymore. You know, it's awful. And of course, Liam's just taken that onto Twitter now. He's just like squabbling with himself.
Yeah. I love the Kinks, and the Kinks always had this thing, that Ray and Dave Davis. But there's a moment in You Really Got Me, I heard Ray Davis talking about this, and I don't know if you remember, but when they go into the solo, they sort of scream, Ray Davis goes, and he said he looked at Dave, and he said, right in front of me, I saw the council house, the growing up, all the tough times, and I knew... that we'd broke out, we'd found the door, we'd found the exit. I mean, you must have had moments like that.
Yeah, you know, being on, you know, when you're on TV for the first time, you know, or when I remember I was at the point when Liam signed his first autograph. You know, somebody came up to him and said, "Can I have your autograph?" And it's almost like they were speaking Swahili to him. And he kind of signed it, and we were all going, "Ooh, your autograph, eh? Look at that!" And he's looking at me, going, "What do you do here?" I said, "Just write your name." What am I fucking writing my name for? Just write it. Just sign the thing. You know, best wishes.
He must have heard the concept of the autograph before.
Well, he clearly had freaked him out.
Marvelous. So I've grown to love the album.
Thank you very much.
And I'm glad about that, because I thought this is going to be an awkward interview at the moment. I can't find my way around it. And then it entered my consciousness.
Well, good.
So,
I hope it stays there for a while.
I have one complaint about the album. Can I give it you?
Yes, of course.
There is a track on it which you use as sort of packaging. It's you use it as a sort of interlude,
oh,
and
yeah.
then again at the end.
Wednesday.
And it's a great piece of music. And I thought, why didn't Noel put some words on this?
Couldn't get it. Couldn't. It just, the words and the melody would not come. And then we were toying with the running order and we split it into two. And it just worked. But there's quite a bit of music left over from those sessions where it just wouldn't happen, you know. And I'll probably revisit them one day. But I don't know why some songs are really easy to find your way into and some are really difficult, you know, and that one just wouldn't have it at all.
Oh, it's annoying that. It's like it's just waiting to be a hit, that song, I think.
Oh, thanks. Well, I don't know.
Have another look.
Maybe someone will put a little rap on it or something.
So you, when's the autobiography coming out? It's a bit overdue, isn't it?
I do get asked and I've been offered.
I bet you've been offered a lot of money.
Been offered quite a bit of money, but a few friends of mine have written books, like for example Johnny Marr, and I would, you know, this went on for years. I would say, "What are you up to?" He's, "Oh, I'm still writing a book." And I was like, "I'm never going to write a book if it takes this long." And I was saying to him, "What? How do you go about it?" And he was saying, "Well, you could devote like 4 or 5 hours a day to it." I'm like, 4 or 5 hours a day? That's like being back at school. Or I suppose you could take the Keith Richards approach where you get someone else to write it.
Well, a lot of people do that. They just talk to somebody for a while and then they write it.
No, but then it's someone else's words. I don't know. I did a tour blog once, which just freaked me out. You know, it's like they call me and say, "Have you got your blog ready for today?" I'm like, "God, I've got to come up with another one of these things. You know, I have to make stories up now." And but I don't.
It's a shame because it really feels like you've got a good one in you. Do you know what I mean? Because there aren't that many articulate people who I think could properly, as you say,
Wayne Rooney's written 3 on it already.
Yeah, I don't know if he's actually read them. but I think that I would be disappointed if you used a ghostwriter because I would want to hear the words.
Yeah.
Words is your business.
Yeah.
After all.
I would, maybe one day, I'd have to sell the idea to myself. Really.
And you'd have to take time off from others. But you got three or four albums sitting the back burner.
I know, but I'm just inherently lazy is what I am. I'm just like, I can't be bothered with this. Like hacking away at an iPad. You know, I was born in 1967, you know. But have you read Morrissey's book?
I haven't read it, but people rave about that.
Oh, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
Is the way of his words. There's a great line in it where one of his record company bosses had refused to put this album, some album they were making out, and the Smiths insisted that it come out. And they had, so it went to number one, and they had a party, the record company, and the record company boss was at this party, and Morrissey says, and there in the corner, he was skulking in the corner, looking like an untouched sandwich at a sad buffet.
You see, you'd love it. Oh. I think you'd absolutely love it. So, what have you got any ambitions left?
No, they're all musical, and.
But what are they? They're just to continue.
Just to continue. I'd like. There's nothing I'd like to achieve that I haven't already got. So no, not really. Not really.
You got to be careful if you run out of ambitions, though, haven't you?
You start whittling then, don't you? Or you kind of like...
Yeah, exactly.
Should we get a shed? We should get a shed. You know.
Whittling would be, yeah.
Whittling.
I'd like to see that. What a documentary that could be.
One man's quest to whittle.
But you've been doing quite a bit of radio and stuff.
Yeah.
Do you think about moving in... You know how Ricky Wilson's become a presenter? And does a good job at it.
Yeah, and it's not something I like. You know what? If I ever fell out of love with what I do, then I would probably feel the need to do something else. But I love what I do, and it still fascinates me. And you know, it's still the greatest thing ever is to, you know, to travel the world and play your songs. You know, to kids in South Korea, albeit some of them with Man United kits on, come to the gig and you walk out and just before you start a note, just go, really?
That's a misjudgment, really? Yeah. Isn't it?
No need.
So, look, do you feel pressure about Liam's album went straight in at number one?
Mm.
I'm assuming life would have been easier for you if it had flopped.
The funny thing is when he released it, all the Oasis back catalogue went back into the charts. And I was thinking, why have I not thought of this before? Why? This is just amazing. I'm kind of like, I'm sitting watching Match of the Day. He's playing a festival in Albania, 13th on the bill. And I'm like, this is genius. Why? I've called my manager saying, why didn't we do this earlier?
But it must have crossed your mind that you have to do better.
Well, you can't. Our two operations are vastly different. I've run my own record label. It's not affiliated. I haven't got a record deal with anybody. So, but I don't. I honestly, genuinely, couldn't care less.
Really?
The music. If I wasn't happy with the album itself, then I might feel a bit of pressure. But I know it's a great record. I don't care what it sells. I genuinely don't care.
That's a great place to be.
Yeah, I don't. I just, you know. As long as I can muster the enthusiasm to make another one after this, then I'm winning, you know.
Well, like I say, it was. I mean, and the publicity has been great. The scissors was a masterstroke.
I gotta say, right. So the girl was rehearsing the song with the French bit in for Jules Holland, and fair play to Jules. I'll tell you what he said on the night. So I'm saying to her, before the thing comes in, play a tambourine or something. And she did that dismissive thing that French women do. I will not play the tambourine. Like, oh, the shaker? I will not play no shaker. And I was like, well, can you do something? And she said, I play the scissors. And I was kind of putting my in-ear monitors out. Sorry, for a second there, I thought you said scissors. So she's in her own band called The Volume Curb, and she's a singer, but she plays the scissors, right? So I said, can you bring the scissors into rehearsals tomorrow then? And in she came, and when she took it, she's wearing a cape at the time, and when she started playing them, I leant into my bass player and I went, do you hear that sound? And he went, what, the scissors? I went, no, that's the sound of Liam glassing himself when he sees this. So we get to Jules Holland and please bring the scissors. So she brings the scissors. Just as we're about to go live, I said to Jules, mention that it's the first time ever on British television a scissor player. And sadly, Liam didn't glass himself because he was tweeting about it.
There's still time. Night.
There's still time, yeah. But it's the funniest thing. I was in Manchester the night it aired on the Saturday night, and I was in the front seat of a car, and it stopped at the traffic lights, and the car got surrounded by a load of geezers just going, scissors, scissors, doing this, scissors. And I was kind of doing that nervous laugh in the front seat. The taxi driver's going, what are they going on about, mate? And I was like, I really don't know. Caesars.
But did he let you off with the fare?
He let me off with the 260.
Yeah, oh, well, that's...
I won't charge you for this, mate.
Then all is well with the world. Well, look, I respect for pushing the boat out a bit with this album.
Thank you very much.
I think there's stuff on it which I just listen to over and over and over again.
Oh, thank you very much.
Which is great. And you've been supporting you too, which I didn't understand that. I thought, what, Noel Gallagher's supporting people now?
It was the best fun I've ever had on tour. We were off stage at like 10 past eight every night, just thinking, this is unbelievable. Got paid a shitload of money as well. It was unbelievable.
That's the 50-year-old man talking there, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Oh, back on for 9 o'clock.
Yeah. Be back in the spa in my slippers for 10. Well, it was great fun.
So, Noel, I'll speak to you in 17 years' time.
Well,
I might be coming to you through a medium. But hopefully you'll still be... those four albums on the back burner will be out by then.
Yeah, indeed. We can discuss it then.
Okay, so take care of yourself, and may your album sell in vast quantities.
Thank you very much.